Hi guys, in this video we are going to cover the securities market related current affairs pertaining to SEBI for the month of January 2019, which is going to be very important for the upcoming SEBI Grade A 2019 examination. So the first part of the January 2019 current affairs we have already discussed in the previous video. Now in this particular video we are going to discuss the second part. So we are going to continue our discussion, and at the end we are also going to discuss some important MCQs based on this topic. Now before proceeding forward, let me quickly tell you about the excellent results that we have achieved over the past few years. Now in 2017, in RBI Grade B, we had 27 final selections from our students, and in ABAD Grade A, we had 11 final selections from our students. And in 2018, we repeated the same success story, and in RBI Grade B, we had 70 plus final selections, and in ABAD Grade A, we had 26 final selections. Also, in 2018 SEBI Grade A examination, out of the total 84 selections, 41 of our students, they made it to the final list. And in the IBPS AFO examination, our students have got 100 plus interview calls. Now, if I talk about the different individual courses that we are providing, then they include RBI Grade B, SEBI Grade A, NABARD Grade A, RBI Assistant and IBPS AFO examinations. Now, apart from running the separate courses for all those individual examinations, we are also having some combo courses which you can avail. So, we have a combo for RBI Grade B, NABARD Grade A and SEBI Grade A. We are also having a combo for RBI Grade B, NABARD Grade A, SEBI Grade A, RBI Grade B and NABARD Grade A and SEBI Grade A. So, we have all the requisite combos that you can choose from, and you can choose the appropriate course as per your requirements. Let me also tell you about our new course, which is very important for all the banking exams. This is the QRE course. QRE, that is Quantitative Aptitude, Reasoning Ability and English. So all these aspects which are very important for all the banking exams, they are going to be covered in this particular course. So let's start with the first news item, which is the norms for mutual fund derivative investments have been now put in by SEBI. So SEBI has recently decided to allow the mutual funds that they can write the call options subject to certain conditions. Now mutual funds, we are already aware about, they are the funds which are investing into a set of securities, they are building up a portfolio, and people are indirectly investing in the portfolio by purchasing the units of the mutual fund. So SEBI has now allowed these mutual funds that they can write call options. So what are call options? Call options, they refer to an agreement that gives the buyer the right to purchase an asset at a specified price within a particular time period. So when you are writing a call option, you have a right that you can purchase any asset for which you are writing the call option at a particular time in the future at a specified price which you have already decided. So SEBI has said that the mutual fund schemes except the index funds and exchange traded funds, they can now write call options only under a covered call strategy. So what does this mean? This means that if you are having the actual shares with you, then only you can write this covered call strategy for constituent stocks of Nifty 50 and Sensex indices. So this has been brought in by SEBI, and this mutual funds, they can now write the call options. Currently, the mutual fund schemes, they are permitted to undertake transactions in equity derivatives but cannot write the options. So now they can write the options, but that has to be under a covered strategy. Now if we learn more about these derivative instruments, then the derivative is basically an instrument whose value is derived from some underlying asset. Now this underlying asset can be commodity, this can be precious metal, currency, bond, stock or anything. This can be anything. This underlying asset can be anything, and this is going to influence the value of the derivative. Now most common example of derivative instruments, they include forward, future, options and swap, which you must have already learned about in your finance topic. And if you talk about the options, then they are the financial derivatives in which the buyer gets a right but not the obligation. If you get the option, if you buy the option, you pay certain premium and you get the right but not the obligation to buy or sell. If you have to buy, this is a call option, and if you have to sell, this is a put option and an underlying asset at an particular price at a particular point of time in future. So this is about the concept of options, and if you want to learn more about it, you can always refer your detailed notes for it. And the call options and put options, they form the wide range of options strategies which have been designed for hedging, protection or speculation. So basically, you can undergo hedging, you can go protection or speculation through the use of call and put option strategies. So this is about the derivative instruments. Next is SEBI plans to relax norms for the real estate investment trust and the infrastructure investment trust. So SEBI is now planning to relax the norms for these particular trust. For these particular trust, SEBI had notified the regulations for REITs in 2014, which permitted setting up and listing up of such trust, which are very popular in some advanced markets. So now SEBI has proposed a new set of framework for these particular trust or investment vehicles in order to provide flexibility to the issuers in terms of fundraising and increasing the access of these investment vehicles to the investors. So now basically the flexibility is being provided and the focus is on increasing the access of these particular investment vehicles. Now as per the proposal, the minimum allotment and a trading lot for publicly issued real estate investment trust, that is REITs, and infrastructure investment trust, that is INVITs, this will be reduced. So if the minimum allotment amount and the trading lot, this is going to be reduced, this means that more people, they can now enter into the market, because now with lesser amount of money you will be able to get into the market for these particular instruments. So if you learn more about this particular news, now, despite the various regulations which have been given by SEBI for these particular investment vehicles, they have basically failed to attract the investors. That's why SEBI is now mulling out some new kind of reforms. So these proposals, they are aimed at providing flexibility to the issuers and as well as increasing the access of these investment vehicles to the investors, as we have already seen on the previous slide. At the time of initial or the follow-on issue, so whenever they come up with an issue of units or securities, the minimum application and allotment lot shall be 100 units and the value of one such lot shall be within the range of 15,000 to 20,000. So minimum lot shall be 100 and the value of the minimum lot shall be between 15K to 20K. Now currently, in the case of an REIT issue, the minimum subscription from any investor in an initial offer or follow-on offer is not less than rupees 2 lakh, while the same is rupees 10 lakh in the case of INVIT. So now this is going to be very easy for investors to participate, because they there is no need to invest such a hefty amount of 2 lakh or 10 lakh. They can now just become a member by putting in 15 to 20,000 only. Further, the trading lot for the purpose of trading of the units of the REET on the stock exchange is rupees 1 lakh and rupees 5 lakh for INVIT. So now this is going to be reduced to just 100 units. So this is going to be very helpful. And the trading lot for the existing publicly issued and listed units should be reduced by the stock exchange within a period of 6 months from the date of notification of these regulations. So the steps are going to be taken in a phased manner. The amounts, they are going to be reduced in a phased manner in the time span of 6 months. Now next news item is about a new format for the mutual funds report. So we've already seen about the concept of mutual funds and we already know about them. So quite basically they are the alternatives between the stocks and the bonds. So in stocks there is a huge amount of risk and in bonds they are mostly risk free. But in mutual fund, they have a combination of both these securities. You can invest in the stocks, you can invest in the bonds through the mutual funds, and the fund manager is going to take care about your investment and you are not going to be worried. So you can get excellent returns from the stock market and you can get these at a lower amount of risk as in the bonds segment. So SEBI has recently come out with a new format for the asset management companies for monthly cumulative reporting. So first of all, we must be aware that the asset management companies, they are the ones which are managing the assets of a mutual fund. They have to give in their reporting to the mutual funds. So now they have to give in this reporting in a monthly cumulative reporting format. And from the April 2019 onwards, these asset management companies will have to submit this MCR to SEBI in this new format by the third working day of each month. So by when it is to be submitted? By the third working day of each month. Now, in this monthly cumulative report or MCR, the asset management companies, they will have to separately disclose about the number of schemes in each segment. So mutual fund generally have different schemes in different segment, like they have some equity schemes, debt schemes, hybrid schemes, and including open-ended, close-ended or equity-oriented schemes. So all this information is going to be disclosed. Open-ended schemes, they are the ones in which you can easily enter or exit anytime. You can sell your units to the mutual fund and get back your money anytime. But for close-ended schemes, you cannot enter or exit anytime. You can only exit at the end of the tenure of the fund. Otherwise, what you can do, you can sell your units to some other person because mutual fund is not going to buy them. And in equity oriented schemes, the mutual fund is basically investing most of its corpus in the equity shares. Now, next news item is about commodity indices. So we are already aware about stock indices like Sensex and Nifty are there, but now SEBI is mooting about the commodity indices. So SEBI has proposed allowing commodity exchanges to create indices on which future contracts can be introduced. So we have already seen that derivative contracts can be based on underlying asset, and this underlying asset can even be an indice or index. So if the commodity exchanges, they come up with this commodity index, then new derivative instruments can be issued which will be based on these particular indices. Now, index-based products, they will also encourage the participation of institutions such as mutual funds, insurance companies, etc. in the commodity derivative market. So if there is an index and the products, they are based on this particular index, this would involve building up of a fund which would track up this particular index. So if this fund building is required, this would definitely involve mutual funds or big insurance companies that would come into play in the commodity derivative market. Further, trading in the derivative products on commodity indices may also increase liquidity in the underlying commodity derivative product. So this would also lead to increase in the liquidity of the underlying commodity derivative product, because now there is going to be a derivative to hedge the exposure in that particular commodity. Now, incidentally, the Commodity Derivative Advisory Committee has recommended that to begin with, the future contracts on commodity indices may be launched by the exchanges. So this has also been recommended by the Commodity Derivative Advisory Committee that the future contract on commodity indices should be launched. So SEBI has proposed that the indices can include as constituents only those commodity contracts that have been in existence on the respective exchange for at least previous 12 months, and they are traded for at least 90% of the trading days in the stipulated period. So new commodities, they cannot be permitted. New contracts, they cannot be permitted. The old contracts which have their established presence on that particular commodity exchange, that only can now, for the initial period, can be used for the construction of a commodity indice. Now, next is about the norms for depository participants. So we are all aware that now the securities, they have to be kept in a DMAT format, and for keeping those securities in a DMAT, that is dematerialized format, you would have to open up your account with the depository participants. So for these depository participants, SEBI has come out with the new set of norms. So the employees of the public financial institutions, as well as those without any identifiable ultimate promoters, they will not be considered as depository participant under the SEBI norms. So there are different sorts of SEBI norms, and one is with regard to the depository participant, and SEBI wants to ensure that when we talk about the depository participant, only the unassociated persons, they become depository participant. It should not be happen. If person A is a depository participant, then its relative person B could also be a depository participant, because this would ultimately reduce the competition in the market. So in this regard, these new norms, they have been issued to basically provide clarity in this front. So let me start with the third point, because the first may not go with our course of discussion. The third point is, a person who is a director in an entity that itself is a depository participant, or that company's associate company is a depository participant, then the same will also be considered as depository participant. So that director cannot become a depository participant separately, because he is already director of an entity which is depository participant. But if you talk about the case of public financial institutions, they are very large financial institutions, and if a person is a director, is an employee of the public financial institution, then in that particular case, it would be very difficult to say that that person is also a depository participant, because in practice, he is not a depository participant. So in this regard, basically clarity have been given that the employees of the public financial institutions, as well as those without any identifiable ultimate promoter. So for these institutions, there is no ultimate promoter. They may be backed by the government or anything. They will not be considered as depository participant under the SEBI norms. So as per SEBI, a person will not be considered depository participant or its associate if the same is on the board of a public financial institutions or public sector bank or which has no identifiable ultimate promoter. So basically, if you are on the board of any public sector bank or any public financial institution, this does not mean that you are basically owning that institution or bank. You are basically just on the board of that particular institution. So in that particular case, you will not be considered as depository participant. But if we are not talking about the public financial institutions or the public sector bank, we are talking about any general entity, then for any general entity, if you are a director of that, you would also be considered as depository participant, because let's face it, you are not separate from that entity. You are very much intertwined, they are very much interlinked with that particular entity. So SEBI has issued this circular providing clarity on certain provisions of regulations related to the depository participants. So basically the first two were with regard to the clarity part, and the third one was with regard to the restriction part. So if we learn about the depositories, then basically these are the places where the financial securities or the shares, they are held in the DMAT form. So when the shares are with us in the DMAT form, they are basically backed by the depositories. So depositories, they are responsible for maintaining the ownership records and they facilitate the trading in the DMAT securities. But we are not directly dealing with the depositories. We are dealing with the depository participants. Depository participants, they are the agent of the depository and they are the intermediaries between the depository and the investors. So what we do, we open up an account with the depository participant, and through this particular account, we are able to get the shares in the DMAT form. So this is how the whole picture looks like. On the top, there is a depository, like there is Central Depository Services Limited or National Securities Depository Limited. And then we have the depository participants like ICICI Direct, Sher Khan, HDFC Securities, etc. And then finally, there is you, that is the customer. So you are interacting with the depository participant, which is in turn interacting with the depository. You are not directly interacting with the depository. Now next is about the government to clip SEBI's wings. So Finance Ministry has recently directed SEBI to submit proposed regulations to an independent committee for vetting before they are passed by the regulators board. So Finance Ministry now wants that any regulation which is to be passed by the SEBI, it should be initially examined by an independent committee. SEBI should not simply go ahead by itself on that particular regulation. Now, it is not clear as of now if the new committee will comprise external members or independent directors on the SEBI board. In either case, the objective is that the Finance Ministry's Department of Economic Affairs will have its say with regard to naming of the members of this particular committee. So this move has basically revived the autonomy versus accountability debate at the India's financial market regulators. So SEBI must have its autonomy, but at the same time, it should also be accountable to the government. So is this going to intervene with its autonomy if the government is going to constitute a new body within it, or this is going to make SEBI more accountable? This is going to be something of a debate. From an accountability of SEBI perspective, it can be seen as a good move. But if you talk about the autonomy perspective, then it may hamper its autonomy because the government may directly intervene in the SEBI's actions. Now, if you learn more about this particular news, SEBI Act prescribes that half of its directors have to be independent. It means that they should not be having any other monetary relationship with the SEBI. However, its board currently has 8 members, including the chairman and 4 whole-time directors named by the government. So there are less than half of the board which is made up of the independent directors. So right now, we are not having more than half of the directors as independent directors. So this issue of regulatory autonomy, this has bubbled up to the surface in October when RBI Deputy Governor Viral Acharya spoke about the importance of the central bank independence. So initially this issue came up when the government decided to clip the wings of the RBI, and this issue was raised by the RBI Deputy Governor. And now the ball has shifted into the SEBI's court. Now the SEBI, now the government is trying to clip the wings of the SEBI. So even though SEBI has always made its regulations independently, the flip side is lack of transparency. There is no transparency. However, under its current chairman, Ajay Tyagi, SEBI has adopted a committee-based approach for drafting key regulations. So in his around 21 months tenure, and this we are talking about from the month of January perspective, Tyagi has set a unique record by constituting 15 committees, including working groups, and introducing a whooping 34 consultation papers. So the new chairman is serious about the transparency, serious about the accountability part, but the government is very much serious about clipping the SEBI's wings. Now next is central counterparty status to clearing corporations. So SEBI has granted qualifying central counterparty status, QCCP. So this is something which we must know. This is a new term for us. To two clearing corporations which are operating in the GIFT City, that is Gujarat International Finance Tech City, which is an international financial services center about which we have learnt many a times. Now, QCCP. QCCP is basically related to the clearing of the securities and the settlement of the securities in the market. So, we are going to learn more about these clearing parties, clearing counterparties, and the clearing corporations in the coming slide. For now, let's just see what this perspective is about, what this news is about. So, QCCP member is subjected to lower capital requirement under the Basel III framework, which is, has been introduced by the Basel Committee on the Banking Supervision. So, QCCP, they are basically related to both the banking front as well as the securities front, and they are regulated. The clearing corporations, they are regulated by the SEBI and the RBI also for the select products. And since they are also under the SEBI, they are also under the RBI ambit, that's why they are also going to have certain Basel III framework requirements. The two entities, they are International Clearing Corporation and NSE-IFSC Clearing Corporation. So basically, we have to remember that two QCCPs have been given approval. QCCPs, they are regulated both by SEBI and RBI for certain products, and they have to comply also with the Basel III framework, although with lower capital requirements. So if you talk about the central counterparty clearing houses, they are basically financial organizations which have been created with the objective of easing the trading in derivatives and equities and guaranteeing efficiency and stability in the financial markets. Now they are basically performing two sets of functions. One is clearing function and one is the settlement function. When we talk about the clearing function, they become the counterparty to the buyer and the seller and define what is required from each party to a transaction to reduce the counterparty credit risk, and they guarantee the settlement of the operation even if one of the party defaults. So they are basically assisting in the clearing process when the buyer and seller, they are interacting to deal with the certain securities. In the settlement process, they oversee the correct and timely transfer of securities and capital between the parties to complete the transaction. So what do they actually do? Now the things will become more clear if you look at this particular diagram. Now this diagram has been framed from the perspective of basically the derivative transactions, but let's just understand it from the normal securities transactions. So on the one side there is a seller, and on the other side there is a buyer of securities. So seller, basically what he will do, he will transfer the securities to the clearing corporation, and the buyer, he will make the payment, he will transfer the amount to the clearing corporation. The clearing corporation will ultimately transfer the payment to the seller, and he will transfer the securities to the buyer. So in this regard, it is fulfilling the clearing and the settlement function. Now next is, new rule will give surplus reserves of SEBI and pension regulator to the government. Now the central government has decided to frame a rule that would mandate the regulators and other autonomous bodies to transfer the surplus funds to the exchequer. So this move is going to make SEBI and a dozen of other regulators such as IRDA and PFRDA to shell out a significant portion of their reserves into the Consolidated Fund of India. So this has made quite a few headlines as of now. But then again, let's wait for the more updates when we talk about the current affairs of the coming months also. So the center has been eyeing these resources so that they would help in reduction of the fiscal deficit of the governments. Experts, however, are saying that this could infringe on the independence on the regulatory bodies. So again, the issue of independence has arisen. Now let's discuss some of the MCQs which can be asked of this particular portion in examination. So let's start with the first question. From April 2019, asset management companies, that is AMCs of mutual funds, will have to submit the MCR, that is monthly cumulative reporting, to SEBI in the new format by, the options are 3rd working day of each month, 6th working day of each month, 10th working day of each month, or none of the above. So this we have discussed, that this things are going to change a bit from the April 2019, and this report is going to be submitted by the AMCs by the 3rd working day of each month. So the answer to this is going to be option number 1. Next question. As per SEBI norms on depository participants, employees of public financial institutions as well as those without any identifiable ultimate promoters will not be considered as repository participants. A person who is a director in an entity that itself is a depository participant or has associate as depository participant, then the same will be considered as a depository participant, both of the above or none of the above. So guys, we have discussed about the new norms with regard to the depository participants that have been brought in by SEBI, and we have discussed that the employees of the public financial institutions, they are not going to be considered as depository participants, but the persons who are the director of an entity which is a depository participant or its associate, then they are going to be considered as depository participant, because SEBI does not want that same person should again become depository participant, or the associate entities should take different licenses as depository participants, because this may create a decline of competition in the market. So that's why these conditions have been put in, and the answer to this is going to be option number 3, both of the above. Next question, which of the following is incorrect in the context of SEBI's independence? Options are, SEBI Act prescribes that half of its directors be independent. Finance Ministry has recently directed SEBI to submit proposed regulations to an independent committee for vetting before they are passed by its board. Both of the above or none of the above. So this we have discussed, that how the Finance Ministry is now trying to put in a committee which is going to vet all the SEBI regulations. So in this regard, both these, they are the correct statements. So the answer is going to be none of the above is incorrect. That is option number 4. Next question. SEBI said it has granted QCCP status to two clearing corporations operating in Gujarat International Finance Tech City and International Financial Services Center, that is GIFT IFSC, recently. Now in this regard, QCCP stands for, options are, qualifying central counterparty, quoted central counterparty, qualifying central corporation, none of the above. So this we have learned, this we have understood, that this QCCP stands for qualifying central counterparty, which is basically an intermediary for clearing and settlement of the transactions. So the answer to this is going to be option number 1. Next question, TK Vishwanathan committee in the context of securities market is related to. Options are, primary market reforms, mutual fund reforms, commodity exchanges, or insider trading. So this we have seen, we have understood about the TK Vishwanathan committee when we talked about insider trading. So here the answer is going to be option number 4. So guys, these are the answers to the questions. So guys, this was all about our discussion. If you are having any query, you can mail us at hello@edutap.co.in, or you can reach us at 8146207241. You can call us or you can WhatsApp us. And I would also recommend that you visit our website www.edutap.co.in for regular updates and important content on the respective examinations. Thank you guys. I wish you happy learning and all the best from the entire team.